Hello and welcome to Microsoft Mechanics Live. Coming up, we're going to have a look at a special edition of How We Built It on Microsoft Mechanics, live from Amsterdam. We're going to learn how Symantec, a global leader in cybersecurity, was able to shift from their complex self-managed database infrastructure to a geographically dispersed and low-latency database solution using Azure Cosmos DB, all with minimal code changes and no downtime. And we're also going to look at how this was accelerated with their work as they actually accelerated into insights-driven DevOps in that model for continuous iteration and also threat detection services, all the things that they're doing as part of Symantec. So I'm joined today by the technical architect, Michael Shavell from Symantec. Please give him a warm welcome.
It's really great to be here at Ignite and, of course, in Amsterdam.
Now, before we go deep into the work that you've done and actually the team has done to move to the cloud services that you're using now as part of what you're doing with Symantec, a lot of people know Symantec from antivirus protection, but you do a lot more. Can you give a description about what Symantec does in totality?
Yeah, so originally we were the antivirus company, but we really have so many more solutions now. We're focused around protecting the identity and data across devices and services, and this is really as we move into the cloud generation where things are heading. Norton Security, as many of you guys might know from our consumer business unit, focuses on antivirus, anti-spam, anti-malware services to keep your computers and devices safe. My team is actually focused around 43 services, half of them being security and other pieces delivering overall user experience. These really are the back-end services that provide file, web, and IP reputation across the web, but also really importantly now moving into Wi-Fi, and then some other pieces like authentication, including two-factor authentication, user policy, and notification.
And right, just to put this in the context for everyone who's here, what's the scale of your global operation?
So the security services themselves get about 5 billion endpoint requests per day. We see almost 12 billion in total across all of them. And customers are globally relying on these checks in order to provide URL, file, Wi-Fi, and app reputations to figure out what's secure, where should I be visiting. So the protection has to work silently behind the scenes. We can't be impacting productivity. We can't be right in their face. So we have a 5-second SLA to understand and intercept threats. If we don't meet that, we actually can't protect the user. So that's not a position we would ever want to be in. And it's really 5 seconds is a worst case scenario.
And the great thing is it works if you're offline or online, but what's the typical response time?
Yep, internal in our servers, we strive for a 2 to 5 second turnaround. So when you add a worldwide latency of maybe up to 100 milliseconds for those endpoints is really where we're striving to be.
All right, so let's dig into the latest, the tech architecture you're using now. What does that look like in terms of running your reputation service?
Of course, you have to have an endpoint to protect your device. So as a user, you would have installed Norton Antivirus or Norton Security on your device, maybe Norton Mobile Security. And what these are doing is watching for unusual processes on your devices. Malicious activity, maybe things like disk encryption, which is what happened with the WannaCry outbreak. So as I mentioned, we have about 5 seconds, actually sub-5-second SLA to deal with these threats. So our agent actually goes and communicates with our back-end services. To minimize the latency worldwide, we leverage Azure Traffic Manager. This allows us to route the requests accurately to the closest data center to get the best performance. Sitting behind there is actually Azure VM scale sets that allow us to grow and contract to the needs in the given day. So just to set context, any one endpoint that's hitting our services may make up to 100 queries against Cosmos on the back end. So if we take our file reputation service as an example, once you download a file on your device, it calls one of our services, one of those reputations get returned on our machines. We use machine learning algorithms, among other technologies, to actually determine the state of the file. We hold on to it before it's allowed to be executed for a very short time. That's where that 5 seconds come in, till we determine it's safe, where we unlock it and allow it to be executed. So on the back end, this actually communicates with Azure Cosmos DB in order to decide if the file process is known, good, bad, and then actually feeds that back to the user very rapidly, and then we can decide if it's malicious. If we do decide that it's a bad file, we go ahead and we actually just completely remove it and stop it.
Very cool. So what happens then if it's a brand new file that's never been seen before by the service?
That's great. So the telemetry is super important. So every hit to our services is logged by our eventing system and then analyzed to keep up to date with new and emerging threats. We need a very short active feedback loop. So if a file is weaponized, after it has been downloaded, you have a behavior analysis that occurs. We will detect something is going bad. This anomalous behavior is very rapidly logged, such as the file maybe immediately turns around and starts encrypting stuff. Not good. Right. So our clients have logic to understand that something is not going well, and we can short circuit that process and stop it while we go ahead and analyze those files. From there, we actually output these reputation values, and then in this case, we're going to call it a bad file. And we run it through our proprietary reputation system, which actually goes ahead and injects it back into Cosmos DB for fast recall on all those other machines. So it's really important that we continually update our database models to return fast, accurate verdicts that also trigger protections in the background to user machines by blocking the bad processes.
And it's really cool. All of this really typically happens silently in the background within usually 2 to 5 milliseconds. So it's really amazing in terms of how fast that is.
Yeah, and worldwide, we're always striving to drive this latency down, which is why we're expanding these services into so many regions.
Right, so you also mentioned WannaCry. How well were you able to handle with a threat like WannaCry?
Yeah, that was a really interesting morning. I was commuting into Boston on my train, and we saw an elevated bit of response. So we were seeing 20 to 30 extra thousand requests per second. The interesting thing was Symantec automatically, with our systems, shut that entire attack down, and we were able to just remove it without any human interaction.
So you've made a couple of really important tech decisions then at Symantec to make a shift to using basically managed cloud services as part of your migration or your upgrade.
Right, so 4 years ago we were actually in on-prem data centers, so we were very restricted with what we can use, and there was no managed services.
Okay, so where did that all start then?
Yep, so the first thing, telemetry is our lifeblood. We can see how it's tied into all these reputation systems. So the first service we saw when we moved to cloud is we grabbed Azure Event Hubs, because gave us a lot of confidence. We were able to utilize this service. It was up, we got a great SLA, and it just worked, and we turned our detection system down to minutes, a full turnaround in minutes. So this combines with the behavior blocking on the clients for good, you know, zero-day threat protection. Next, we're constantly improving our reputation and notification services, so we adopted Azure Application Insights. So we're actually going to take a look at a dashboard here. This is one of our actual dashboards that we run. It's showing average availability at 100%. Fantastic.
That's always a good thing to see. It's flat at 100%.
Absolutely. So as we take a look at that, fantastic. We go back, we take a look at server response time. Critically important. So this is one of our policy services. Very, very rapid, 60 millisecond response time. Fantastic. And of course, we can see all the errors in our system.
Right.
So leveraging this, core area of focus. However, the other pieces we need to really leverage was Azure Cosmos DB.
So how do you go about then making that transition to Cosmos DB?
So we didn't get there overnight. We had about 5 database solutions prior to Azure Cosmos DB. A core step for us was, of course, to move to the cloud. So we leveraged Cassandra running on IaaS infrastructure. Mm-hmm. So this was actually running on raw VMs. It took a substantial amount of time to build this out, though, because there's just a lot of work to do. You're standing up 30 Cassandra nodes in every region because you have to handle 180,000 requests per second. So
right.
We have to tune the I/O. We have to patch. We have to monitor. Everything is on the engineering teams to do so. So we also, unfortunately, have to overplan for capacity because we have to handle those worst case scenarios. As an engineering team, we had to load test the database because we were responsible. So we had to build an entire load test framework.
Right, and it looks like it's fairly complex to get all of that to run. You've got all of the kind of server OS management and all the patching, all that stuff to do. I can imagine it was really good for known threats in terms of getting this done, but what happens if you got to really scale up fast for things like unknown threats?
Yeah, right. So we always had to balance the risk of the unknown and planning for it. So unfortunately, we were running idle infrastructure anticipating the next big cyber threat, because if it's not ready, we can't handle it.
Right.
So all of that completely went away with Azure Cosmos DB, though. So let's go ahead and take a look here. So interesting thing here is we can take a look and see replicate data globally. We can click a button. I'm not going to because this is, you know, a production database. However, as we expand into Amsterdam, which is our next region, we actually will be just clicking a button, replicating, and moving on. So it really can scale to any level that we're looking for. And we don't only have to load test our own code now. We don't have to load test the infrastructure because we can depend upon Cosmos to handle the load.
Very cool. So that said, shifting that database infrastructure had to be an area of risk, effectively, for Symantec. Now, you're running services that can't have any downtime. After all, this is AV and kind of reputation services, et cetera. How are you able to manage the migration without really impacting services or the users?
Great. So yeah, the interesting thing here was that you guys offer a Cassandra API. So really great. Again, we choose Cassandra API. And as that comes up, go ahead and just create a new Cassandra, and then actually instantiate. So now we can do a very simple migration over with very, very, very minimal code changes. And that allows us to just shift our code, point at the new database, and run. And we did this with our notification platform. Now that service gets about 3.5 billion requests per day. So we were able to shift that, no code change. So imagine what that means. We can task our engineers with working on the next big piece, or maybe some other migration or some other managed service integration.
Yep, it's really cool stuff. And basically, it's just the app thinks it's running in Cassandra. It's running in Cosmos, though, just a few connection strings typically, and everything just works and scales, right?
Absolutely, absolutely. So now, interesting, we also had to develop a way to move our data into other databases. So we actually built a really well-documented database move migration process that actually allowed us to move from database to database. The live migration process actually goes ahead, and what we do for our active users is they come into our APIs, and currently their data is living actually in Cassandra API. So when a REST API hits, we want to move that into Cosmos. Now, this is a high-level visual of our migration process. And there's some pieces we're going to hit on here, like live migration, common migration, and background migration, that are really important.
So how do all these processes then actually work?
Great. So in a live migration process, somebody comes in and hits a REST API. We don't want everybody to move in one shot, because migration is expensive. You have to go to the old database, pull the entire user's record out, perform an ETL process, and then move it into the new one. So you don't want to just flip the switch in one shot. So we take an incremental approach. So we start with 1%. So 1% of our live users start migrating over. And then at that point, we know once the user migrates from Cassandra into Cosmos, in this case, they're now being served out of Cosmos permanently. So we can go ahead and start to slowly ramp this up a little bit as our confidence gains.
Right, so you started then effectively by migrating 1%. How do you get past that first 1% and really start ramping up?
Yeah, so the team actually watches, and our app insight shows us that we're in a healthy state, so we go ahead and we stay at 1%, and then very quickly move to 5%, 10%, 20, 25, 50, and then finally 100%, which is at the point we can actually start running the background migration process.
So how then does the background migration process actually work?
Yep. So the not everybody hits our services every day. In fact, some of our users we might not see for 6 months. Think about it. I have a couple devices that sit in a drawer. Maybe it's a test device, and we won't see them very often. So we have to go ahead and migrate them so we don't have to manage the old database. So we have a Spark job that actually scans the Cassandra DB, and then it gives us back a list of IDs that we can then migrate. Mm-hmm. So our migration engine lives within the service itself, as we showed with that first graphic. However, what we want to do is actually feed it through that same process. So as we see the user and the device ID, we can then go ahead and push them through and figure out, did I migrate this guy? No. OK, so let me go ahead and do this. Now, the really important part there to minimize amount of testing is it's the exact same code flow. You don't want to have two code flows, because everything should be the same in this process. You do not want two different results. It would also double your testing and your stability requirements, because now you're looking at two different code flows. So we utilize the same exact code flow, either from an API or a message bus.
So what else did you have to plan for in terms of, let's talk about things like scale. What did you have to do to really set the right thresholds on scale so that you aren't really paying for resources? You mentioned before that you might have to have 180 requests per second or something, the infrastructure to manage that. How do I do that in Azure then, to where I'm not paying for that kind of overhead of just keeping resources at that peak level?
Yeah, as I mentioned before, we're using application insights tied into all these applications. So we actually combine this with an Azure function, allowing us to do some pretty interesting things. So let's take a look at that. This function is actually how we perform our migration. So we grab some environment variables that are really important. We figure out how far do we want to scale. Do we want to go up by 10%, down by 10%? Then we go ahead, calculate that, log it, and of course, write it back to Application Insights so we know exactly where our trends are. So this is triggered off of 429s, so when we get pushback from the service. Now let's take a look. What does that actually look like? This is our actual running prod resource utilization. So if we look here, we can see on the left, that's our scale trend. That's that function going up and down. And the right is actually our request RUs in one of our really important services that can't go down, leading into a weekend where our enterprise customers get quiet and then heading back into Monday morning where it gets busy again.
And when you think about what you see there on the left, that 320 bar is probably where you'd keep idle infrastructure running on-prem. Yep. So literally all of that white space is stuff that you don't have to pay for. And one thing to point out, if you do hit a 429 code, it means you're going to be throttled. Services aren't going to stop. But the nice thing is it's kind of a good listening mechanism to wait for that throttle to happen. Then you can start bumping up services and start bumping up scale based on those throttles coming in. So those are really cool triggers in terms of being able to kind of right-size the service. But what's next?
So I would say at this point, 50% of our services have been migrated into Cosmos DB over in Azure. So we want to continue and have the rest of our services where appropriate in Azure Cosmos DB by the end of the year.
So really fantastic stuff, Michael. Any final tips that you want to embark on all the folks that are watching today?
Yep, fear of downtime shouldn't get in your way when you're adapting these managed services. They are trustworthy, they work, they function as promised. Cosmos was the first service with an SLA. That's a big deal. So you do need to take a workload-focused approach, though. Figure out what is your service. Can it have downtime? Probably not. Don't do that. And figure out what's the appropriate DB. Okay? Expect to overscale. So when you're dealing with these systems during the migration, you're doing a full migration.
Full move. So all the attributes, all those have to move, right?
All the extra data. So you're going to overscale. But the nice part with Cosmos is as soon as your migration's done, within hours, you go ahead and pull it back down to the appropriate levels. And then you're right-sized, and your cost is accurate to what you want to run at. And then, and then, of course, telemetry is absolutely key. Everything you do through these migration processes should be tracked, and it should be well-defined in your dashboards.
Really cool. So thanks for joining us today, Michael, on how we built it to really share your experience in migrating to Azure Cosmos DB. Now, if you want to learn more about Azure Cosmos DB, you can check out the link here shown. And of course, keep watching Microsoft Mechanics, the latest tech updates. Hit subscribe if you haven't already. We'll see you next time.